Welcome to another week. This is what I'm currently most excited about. And I'm not really talking about ants in general or even this specific species, which is a really cool one. Check out that other video that I made kind of about them. But I'm talking about what I just did with my camera, that is following an individual ant in its natural habitat. So usually all of my experiments are in a very controlled lab setup. And now I also want to take the step outside and follow them in the field. And I've had this idea for a while now. But at the ISSI conference, check out that video, I talked to somebody who did his PhD at the University of and is now at the University of Lausanne. And he is working and has been working on a really, really unique and fascinating type of ant. That is the Matabele ant or Megaponera analis. Those ants raid termites, and when some ants get injured by the termite soldiers, then other ants, sort of paramedics, carry them home and treat the wounds. This is a very unique behavior that is only being seen in this ant species. So at this conference, the researcher, whose name is Eric by the way, asked me whether I wanted to collaborate with him on the search behavior of those ant scouts that scout out the termite nests. Of course I said hell yes, and Anna also was not standing in my way and still is not. There's now just one problem to solve, which I will tell you more about after my visit of the mirror lab, to which we're going in the science communication course again. The problem is that I don't know how to track the ants over those 40 meters or more that they might be running away from their nest, because all the trackers that I have tried so far, they don't really work with a mobile camera, so they all need still images. It doesn't seem to be a trivial task also. I need to contact a lot of people to figure out some possible solutions. Today, by the way, is going to be a really talkative day for me, since now currently I am on my way to a public speaking workshop led by the Cosmopolitan Toastmasters. I was looking at the sky, it opened up, I saw it coming down, I gave it up, and I will begin right then and there. And in our Spanish class, we're going to do pair interviews in Spanish. Ha, that was easy. Fue muy fácil. Morgan and myself, Morgan with whom I did this interview over 4 to 6 minutes, were practicing in the library first for, I don't know, half an hour. And now we gave the interview and it was very smooth, and I think we're gonna get a pretty high percentage. To give you a little taste of that, I said things like interesado en las hormigas porque una hormiga individual es muy estudio, pero una colonia es muy muy inteligente. Not even the angels could compare. I saw it all like a telescope.
Here's a gas leak.
I guess I won an EB beer pong tournament together with Evan, my office mate. I already said last week that this week I am going to be finishing up my thesis proposal, and now I think that this is the last citation that I want to input So how I do it is by using a reference or citation management software. In this case, or in my case, it is Zotero. And this program lets you input some citations into Word or any other text processing program that you might be working with just basically one click and then typing in the author names of the paper that you're thinking of putting in as a citation, then it just puts them in automatically, and at the end you can make a reference list of all of the citations that you have put in to your file. And if you did not have that, then there would be a lot of searching around and typing out names and the years and making sure that everything is correct, and then at the end the reference list also making sure that everything, like, I did it for my first project because I didn't have it back then, or it was not working properly, and so yeah, it's always a mess. And getting all those papers into that software is also made relatively simple. First, you go on to Google Scholar, which is Google for scientific papers. Then you search for something like vlogs, YouTube, and then you see, oh, that's an interesting paper. And then there is a browser plugin which lets you just click one time and that it automatically saves it to your collection. And I think that all different managing softwares do it very similarly. I just like Zotero because it's very simplistic, kind of. But of course, there are pros and cons to everything. Yeah, it's also free, so that's a bonus. Not being paid or anything by them, I just like the software. And now I'm sitting at one of the random computers that are dispersed in our lab that nobody's using anymore, with a press board and speeds, because for two reasons. First, a few weeks ago, Zishan, our collaborator, has sent us some software for tracking the ants that is now better than what I've had before in my lab. And the software runs on Ubuntu, and I don't know yet how to do this, but I will try to do it with one of those computers, and I'm currently trying out which one is the best. And the other reason is, going back to the Africa story, I looked around for people who could help me with that tracking of moving camera problem, and I found a few people. You saw that I visited one guy in the optical sciences department last week. I found another paper who has basically already solved that problem for drones. And basically in my conversations with that author of this paper, I found out that there are two major possibilities to solve the problem. And the first one is with a GPS real-time kinematic tracking, which is based on some fancy equipment of a radio device and coupled with GPS, as the name says. And this is what some farmers use to plant and fertilize their fields with centimeter precision, but it's relatively expensive. The other possibility would be to use some really fancy algorithms that may be inaccurate, but cheap. That means they don't cost any money, but they cost a lot of time to run. Now I'll also try to install one of those at one of those computers and run some test videos. That seems to be a pretty capable computer, so I'm hopeful that once I get the administrator rights, I can actually start analyzing the data that I finally got. I also got two 8 terabyte hard drives to do new experiments, and I'm looking forward to next week, to my committee meeting. Fun times. See you next week.
Astronomy here began at the University of Arizona over 100 years ago through, again, at that time, an anonymous donation by Lavinia Stewart. That time, it was an ostrich farm. The giant Magellan telescope, we're going to be able to see three of those telescope mirrors today. It's going to be a total of 8, 7 in use when it's up in first light. And it's, both of those are going to be located in Las Campanas in Chile. And then we are also part of the James Webb Space Telescope, and we're developing the optics cameras for that. Larger you have as far as mirrors go, the better you can capture light. Produce the largest and most complex hexagonal interior telescope mirrors in the entire world. Low expansion glass. We want it to not be able to expand or contract. It takes about 2.5 years for them to create enough glass for us to make one mirror, so we constantly have it on order.
The first step is to put out a layer of ceramic hexagons on which the glass chunks are being distributed.
Then the furnace is closed, heated to 1200 degrees Celsius, and it starts spinning. The spinning is what will give the mirror its parabolic shape. These are views from the inside of the furnace, and you can see how in the end the air bubbles are rising up. The glass is then allowed to cool by 3 degrees Celsius per day over a 3-month period. Then the raw mirror is lifted out of the furnace with a steel structure.
So in case if you're wondering, no, we have not dropped a mirror. And the adhesive that they're using there is a very exotic version of bath caulk. Which in this part takes the better part of the day. But yes, everyone is holding their breath. Don't worry.
And that guy is making it falls.
That's one of the scariest moves we do in this entire process.
Grinding and polishing the front surface are the final steps in the mirror fabrication. They make the mirror so smooth and accurate that if it were expanded to the size of North America, the tallest hill would be 1 inch high. Through many cycles of polishing and measuring, we gradually make the surface smooth and accurate to a millionth of an inch. At this point, the mirror can form images whose sharpness is limited by the wavelength of light and the size of the mirror, not by the tiny shape errors. We then prepare the finished mirror for shipping to the telescope or a storage facility off campus.
It moves at 3 miles per hour.
Maybe all we got is this one night, but I see forever in your eyes.
Love it and hope to not break it. Right. Polishing, it still takes about 2.5